Here's a list of the players we'll be inviting to camp.
I never heard of half of these guys, and the ones I do know are way past their prime.
Most of these guys never had a prime.
The facts are, we lost our two best players to free agency. We haven't won a pennant in over 35 years. We haven't placed higher than fourth in the last 15. Obviously, it's time for some changes.
This guy here is dead.
Cross him off, then.
Entire world.
Oh, look. This is Charlie Donovan of the Cleveland Indians.
How would you like to manage the Indians this year?
I don't know.
What do you mean you don't know? This is a chance to manage in the big leagues.
Let me think it over, will you, Charlie? I got a guy on the other line about some white walls. I'll talk to you later.
Just a bit outside.
I cannot hit curveball. Straight ball, I hit it very much. Curveball, that's our friend.
Say hey! Billy Mays Hayes here. Play like Mays, and I run like Hayes.
All right, 6 minutes after the hour of 9 o'clock, this is the Mighty 1190 WIXE. Good morning to you. Welcome in to the Talk of the Town segment here on the Mighty 1190. And Archie, wow, you finally got to have him in so you could talk baseball instead of just...
That's exactly right. We welcome into the studio Mike Shildt. He's the manager of the AAA affiliate of the St. Louis Cardinals, the Memphis Redbirds. Hey, Mike.
Hey, Archie. How you doing today?
I'm doing great. I actually looked this up. Now, I've been hearing about the Cardinal Way, and I know some people get tired of hearing about the Cardinal Way, and they said, if it rubs some people the wrong way, we're sorry. The Cardinals aren't apologizing. They don't have to. They do it their way, and it works. But I actually did a little research, and this goes back to George Kissel, is credited. Kissel managed in the Cardinal farm system through 1957. Scouted for them from 58 to 62, returned to the field as a minor league manager from 63 to 67. 68 spent his first season as a roving instructor in the Cardinal system, where his efforts led to his nickname of the Professor, and his influence is generally regarded as being a major basis for what came to be known as the Cardinal Way. And you, to me, you're the epitome of the Cardinal Way. Tell us how you got started
in baseball. Well, Archie, I appreciate that. I'm glad you referenced Mr. Kissel. You know, a very subjective thing, but
yeah,
very potentially the most influential baseball guy of all time, instructionally, and legend in the industry, and obviously a person that we value very highly, and started in 1940 and was signed by Branch Rickey and was with the organization 68 years. So we mentioned the same breath. It was very flattering and humbling. But I got started. I'm a local product from Charlotte down the road, and grew up in the AA clubhouse of the Baltimore Orioles, and where my mom was the secretary of the team. And
Crockett Park.
Yep. Yeah. And, you know, had a lot of opportunity to be exposed to a game and a lot of good baseball people, and learn more through osmosis than I probably realized, and got my love for the game, you know, started there.
Yeah. And some big players coming through.
Yeah, talking about Eddie Murray and Cal Ripken Jr. and John Shelby, Mike Boddicker, and you know, a long list of guys that back then the Orioles, and now they've resurfaced, obviously. But then the Orioles it was actually the Oriole way, you know, back then. They were the winningest franchise from 54 to 79, and you know, they had a lot of continuity in the organization as well, and taught the game, and were a lot of homegrown guys, and it was a special time to grow up and be a part of seeing that.
What's tough about talking with Mike is Mike will never talk about himself, and you got to pull stuff out of him. He'll recognize something if you bring it up, but you actually won the George Kissel Award in 2010 after your success at Johnson City. But even before that, you coach or managed some in high school in Charlotte.
Right. Yeah, I was at West Charlotte High School. I got my start in 1994, kind of cut my teeth there.
Yeah.
I was assistant coach at UNC Asheville prior to that, where I went to school. And like most young coaches and assistant coaches, you think you know everything and you think you want to be the head coach. So I got the opportunity to go to West Charlotte and had just a tremendous experience there. And was real blessed to be able to have a group of guys that put up with me for 3 years while allowed me to kind of figure out what I was doing. But yeah, that's where I got my start.
So you joined the Cardinals organization back in 04, but you worked as a scout for the Major League Scouting Bureau. Tell us about that.
Yeah, what is that? What did you do? What does a scout do?
Yeah, I was really an associate scout, which means I just kind of looked around this area for talent. And
so you went to a lot of baseball games.
I went to a lot of baseball games, and I worked indirectly for at the time I owned an academy here locally on deck, and that was where I got the majority of my income from. This was really just a opportunity
baseball camp
role. Yeah, baseball.
Where you took good players and made them better.
Correct. It was a developmental academy.
Yeah.
But the Major League Scouting Bureau is a organization that is funded by Major League Baseball.
Okay.
And it is a system and a service that's used from all 30 teams. And you have our area guy is a gentleman by the name of Gary Randall. Gary covers the Carolinas and a little bit of Tennessee and Virginia. And Gary's relative job is to go around and see every amateur player he could possibly see.
Wow.
And determine whether they have the ability to play professional or really in most cases Major League Baseball. So he's going to see high school game, Legion games, travel games, obviously college games, and then he's going to send in reports to the varying teams. So I would basically go out for Gary and help qualify players and suggest players to him.
There's so much baseball and so many players. Are you mostly getting tips like from managers or athletic directors? Hey, you got to come see this guy.
Exactly. You know, it's a networking system. You create a base of contacts and it's gotten a little bit easier now. There's more venues where a lot of players are coming and showing at one time. At that time, there wasn't as much of that, and the technology's helped as well.
Mm-hmm.
But effectively, you get calls from umpires, athletic directors, people you may have played against it now in their community that know a player. You know, it's just really any and all avenues that you get a player from.
So you began four seasons from 04 to 07 as an area scout and player development instructor before transitioning to coach for the Cardinals short season teams. You were a hitting coach. You were a bench coach, Batavia position coach. You later served as a hitting coach, Johnson City. And you also made the short list for what, bench coach with the Cardinal or the Cardinals. What do you say? The big team? I don't know.
Yeah.
What's the vernacular? What am I supposed to say?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's a big club. I mean, you know, the Major League team in St. Louis, and, you know, obviously yeah. We have a feeder system and that you alluded to that I've had varying jobs to work with and grow. And so it's been interesting because the thing that Cardinals people may or may not know, especially maybe in this area, is the fact that, you know, we have player development. We draw within our system. Branch Rickey actually started when he was with the Cardinals. We went to the Dodgers, started the minor league system, the farm system.
Hmm.
And Mr. Kissel, back referencing George, our job is to develop players. But one thing that the organization has done over the years, we've also developed, and I'm a perfect example of it, we take our development of our staff seriously. And there's a plan to bring along and grow our staff, which helps grow our players.
And that's the whole Cardinal way.
That's effectively a lot of the Cardinal way. You know, Mark DeJohn is our field coordinator who oversees our instruction. Started me in that and started developing me as a coach, and he started giving me responsibilities to manage long before I thought there was a possibility that I would ever manage in the Cardinal organization.
Yeah.
And so all those different opportunities has strengthened me and been able to put me in a position to handle being able to take more responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
I'd be curious to know, because Major League, baseball is a little bit different from any other sport in the fact that it's not like in football, a player plays in, you know, high school and then they go to college and then they may get a chance to go to the NFL. And then if they wash out in the NFL, they just wash out unless they go to the CFL. There's no minor league
right.
program. What's unique about what y'all do is you get the opportunity when a guy gets hurt or something, when a guy has to have surgery, when a guy sometimes just isn't playing good, he goes back. So you get to see some, it's not all just college kids that are working their way up that you get to see. You get some really big name people that sometimes have to work their way back up
right.
for whatever reason. That's got to be interesting. I mean, you're going along with your normal group of guys, and then all of a sudden, well, oh, by the way, so-and-so is coming to what?
This yeah. season, I don't know how long you had him, but he was rehabbing, Javier Molina,
yep.
catcher for the Cardinals, and you had him. So when he drives up and whatever he's driving.
Yeah, like, do you fuss at him for, like, get the feet straight? I mean,
it's a real quick, Louis Aguayo, one of our coaches, really good guy and played for the Mets a long time. And Coach Form said something that crystallized. You ask a big league player to do something, and you tell a minor league player. So when Yachty comes down, you just effectively say, "What do you need?"
Yeah,
you know, and So it's a different parameters. And to your point, you know, about there are different. It's interesting the dynamic that takes place in a minor league setting, especially maybe at a lower setting. It's you know, you've got it's more cultural based in a sense. You know, half my club at the rookie level when I was in John City would be from Latin America, from the academies down in our academy down in, outside of Santo Domingo, and the other half of the club would be newly drafted guys from high school, junior college, college, and that dynamic. And you get to a higher level, double A, triple A, and you've got guys that have played in the big leagues that are coming back down from the big leagues, that have been hurt, that are rehabbing, that are trying to get their way to the big leagues. So you have a lot of different dynamic in that regard of experiences and you know.
You got to be honest. I don't want you to call names. Sure. Please don't. But be honest. On some of the guys that have come down, the coach in you at any point, have you, maybe you didn't say anything, but have you ever looked and said, this guy needs, you know, he needs to be doing this, or he needs to be, have you ever, or are these guys so polished that they literally just know what they need to do? And
I guess everybody's different.
They just work their way back up.
Yeah, Arch, you know, they, and both are right. Everybody's different. Everybody's got, but mostly the guys are self-aware that they kind of know they know what they're doing.
Are most of them good guys when they come down, or do you have any terrors in the locker room, or is it pretty much
ego problems?
You know, it's interesting, and people are kind of surprised when I say this, and I can only speak for organization. It's probably, and again, you mentioned the Cardinal way. I think this is a part of it. There's a lot of tentacles to it, really. You know, ownership and front office and so forth. But and none of it's high class tech. You know, big time secretive stuff. It's just going about your business the right way. And but to the point about players coming down, we have a lot of really good leadership. Our better players are our strongest character guys. So they come down, they're actually, will invest in our younger players. They'll be extremely humble. They're low maintenance.
Your guys have got to, I mean, you know, you got a big name coming, and you know, for them to play with that person and talk to them in the locker room, and
well, it would
get
be
some
like
tips from them. And yeah, big.
Like it's if Molina comes down, he's a catcher. I'm sure there are other catchers on the team. That's an opportunity. I mean, for those catchers, say, hey, can I bend your ear while you're here?
Yeah, but and that's exactly right. And but a lot of times the guys are kind of, you know, the clubhouse kind of parts, and they kind of have a reverent distance from those guys sometimes. And a lot of guys that maybe have more of an ego or aren't willing to share and just want to come down and get their work in, will allow that distance to stay. But our, you know, Yachty or Chris Carpenter's come down last year or two, and of course retired now, they welcome those guys. Hey, and they reach those guys out, make them comfortable. And so then that's when a lot of the teaching and mentoring and sharing takes place.
Mike, there was one of these baseball movies, and the name escapes me. It wasn't Major League, but it was the one, maybe it was Breaking Training. Was that the one, Shane? Anyway, Scott Bakula was the manager.
I don't know.
You know Scott Bakula.
Yeah, I know who he is.
Okay, you know Walton Goggins from Justified. He was this up-and-coming pitcher. His nickname was Downtown. You familiar with the movie?
I'm familiar, yeah.
Okay. So this kid comes, he's knocking everything out of the park. So they want to call him up. And Scott Bakula, the manager, said he's not ready. The team was the buzz. Anyway, he's not ready. Yeah, he's ready. They want him. Give me another month or two with him. Right? No, he's not ready. So he talks to the kid. He said, I'd like for you not to go, and let me work with you a little more. And the player takes an attitude. You're just standing in my way. So long story short, they call him up. Once the pitchers figure out he likes it down and in or whatever it he likes, they start pitching away to him. He can't hit nothing. And guess what? He goes right back down again. So from your job,
right,
which it took me a little while to wrap my arms around it, and you've won a pennant out there with the AA team, but that's not your job.
Correct.
Your job is to move players. And you will literally, you'll have people coming and going within a day.
Yes.
How do you manage not knowing, you know, because you want to win, you're playing games. Absolutely. And you got, you know.
There's a scoreboard.
There's a scoreboard involved, but that's not your job. They'd love for you to win.
This is the batting lineup if he's here.
Right.
Gosh, how do you manage around that?
It took a while to get used to that, quite honestly, Archie, you know, and not having that. And then. to get your head around that, it really is ultimately about the big league team. We're completely 100% there to develop a player, to give them an opportunity experience for that major league team. And so we're just serving whatever their needs may be, mm-hmm. and it trickles down. And so, you know, they have something takes place, it ripples. AAA has something takes place, you're in AA, it ripples. And, it disrupts your clubhouse, disrupts your lineup, disrupts your continuity. But effectively, that's 100% the reason why we're there.
It's the amazing part of it, or the funny part of it to me, is if you're in that capacity and you got guys coming through and moving up, I'd like to know what the percentage is of just to give an idea how hard it is to play in the major leagues of baseball. I wonder how many minor league players, what the percentage is of guys who go to the major league.
You know, there's the guys that initially sign, regardless where they're from, it's about I've seen different things and heard different things. About 8 to 10% of the guys that sign will have a day in the big leagues.
So 90% of the people who sign will never play out of the minor leagues.
That's correct.
What's that percentage?
About 90%.
Wow.
Now, so 1 in 10 basically will actually.
Wow.
And that's not have a long sustained career. That's play and for the major league
to
team.
To get a day in the big leagues.
Yeah. God knows that's a.
It's a tough, you know. Now that being said, that guys, wow. you know, they're playing for livelihoods and they're professional players.
Oh yeah,
you know, and so they do have an opportunity to be able to make some money in the game as they get up the ladder a little bit, become a free agent. A minor league free agent can make pretty good money, you know, relatively speaking to the society, mm-hmm. and then they can go play winter ball, you know, and they make some money there. And a lot of the Latin players obviously go back home and they play winter ball, and it's a big deal, and it should be. Mm-hmm. And a lot of American players that have established themselves as a good double or triple A player can go down and do well. Or you can go over to Japan now and maybe Korea. And there's opportunities to play. It's kind of like the NBA. Maybe there's players that can't quite make the NBA that make a livelihood being able to play overseas.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's I don't begrudge. I know those guys make a ton of money and it's a little maybe disproportionate, and I can see the people's opinion of that, but to know what guys put through in the back roads and the town.
Yeah,
you know, and not everybody's getting these $100 million contracts.
Right.
A lot of these guys that play in the AA and maybe even the AAA ball, they got a regular job too, right?
They're going to have a regular job in the off season mostly. You know, during the season, it's a full-time job. You know, I mean, those guys are dedicated, and that's the thing I respect so much about them at all levels, because, you know, they're the travels as good as we can make it, but it's mm-hmm. still, you know, in AA, you've got Corpus Christi and then you're in Springfield, and that's a 16-hour bus trip.
Oh.
And you know, I don't know how you slice that. It's a tough trip. And so you've got to be able to take care of your body, get ready to play.
Yeah.
What do guys like you do in off season? I mean, being what you're, do you go and do something in other capacities when it's off season or?
Yeah, I do a couple things. You know, I'm thankful that we have a year contract, so that helps. I mean, you know, we stay pretty busy during the season, but all season I've done some instructional things. There's a nonprofit that I help out with and called Baseball for Life that's started in Charlotte, and occupies a lot of my time, and I enjoy giving back to the community in that regard. And also have helped. We have an instructional league that takes place for a month. I typically work that down in Florida for our younger players that we consider to be our better prospects, to get them a little more training. Mm. And I've gone and, you know, managing the Arizona Fall League during the off season. So
you do some traveling too. I mean, it's off season.
Yeah.
You're like everybody else. You just kind of do what you got to do.
Got to do what you got to do. That's right.
Mike, what does a bench coach do?
A bench coach wears a fair.
Screams at people. I've seen him on television. He's the one.
Yeah. Like I said, he can wear a lot of hats. The first, you know, kind of go in somewhat of order, but he's going to help the big league manager coordinate spring training. You know, the big league manager sets the tempo, obviously, of what they want to cover, but he's the guy that's going to sit down and do the scheduling, make sure all the I's are dotted, T's crossed, people know where they're going. There's a lot of moving parts to it, so he helps set that up. And then on a daily basis, he's going to do a lot of the matchup and screen a lot of the statistics that day for the manager, provide him the opportunity to be able to see this is what we have so he can make decisions during the course of the game. He's going to set up BP schedules. And then during the game, he's going to remind him about running game times or, again, who's getting warmed up in the bullpen or, hey, remember this guy likes to run in this situation.
you know, there's another baseball movie, and I want to ask you what yours is. It's not The Natural. It's that kid. Is it the Rookie?
Yeah, something like that. It's got Rookie.
Anyway, the kid's grandfather owns the team, and the grandfather passes away, leaves the team to the kid.
Right.
So yeah. he wants to be the manager.
Sure.
And all the suits are like, you know, kid, you know, why don't you hang out? We'll let you hang out in the dugout. No, I want to manage. So, well, you don't know nothing about managing. Well, let me give you a scenario. So he gives the one of the old guys gives the kid a setup. What do you do? It's bottom of the eighth, so-and-so. Anyway, what an education I got with that dialogue, because the kid's asking, who's on deck? Who do I have in the bullpen? When did he last pitch? Anybody on base? I mean, there were so many different things. And then he says, I do so-and-so. Well, see, kid, you got it wrong. He said, why would I give away my 3, 4, and 5 hitters? I mean, it was just a great, I can't duplicate it, but that's the kind of thing that's going through a manager's mind. I can't keep
it all straight. There is absolutely no way you or I could remember that.
No.
It's no way.
Just knowing the situation with each, you know, the relationship between each hitter and batter, and Lord knows all the statistics that baseball keeps up with. Sure. You know, he's on parade on a full moon on a Thursday night when it's taco night at the stadium.
Are all those statistics kept for a reason, or is it just a game of statistics? I mean, is there, because you do hear sometimes just some like,
crazy.
Why would they keep up with that? You hear it on television, but I'm guessing there's a reason.
Well, it's a lot of superstition to baseball.
Well, there is a lot of superstition. There is. It's very statistical and numerical based, and to your points, you can get lost in it, you know, and there's so much of it out there, you can get bogged down with the inertia of it, but there's a lot of practicality to it. You know, there is just, you
no,
just,
I mean,
it,
this dialogue in this movie made perfect sense from a baseball standpoint.
I've always thought
it's real.
About what pitcher do you want, a left-hander or right-hander? Yeah. How does this batter do against lefties and righties? All that stuff.
And you've got to be ahead of that 3 batters previously.
It just seems like it's a game where there's awesome. So many statistics kept, and they've been kept for so long that managers and coaches just use those stats.
All right. Well, Mike, let me ask you some people that you have. I was going to ask you what ball players, big names have you discovered? Maybe that's not who have you brought up? Maybe a better way to ask.
Yeah. I've had the opportunity, The reality is the better players, I can't take an ounce of credit for them being able to get to St. Louis.
I understand.
It's their ability and their hard work.
But people you've worked with.
But guys that have come through the system, we've had a fair amount of them. You know, Michael Walker, we had Michael in 2012, and Colton Wong. And, you know, we just, you know, we had Oscar Tavares, and, of course, he just passed away, unfortunately. It's a very, very sad thing that happened in the offseason for us and obviously for his family. But, Trevor Rosenthal, Carlos Martinez, you know, Alan Craig, and Daniel Descalzo, Matt Adams. You know, the lion's share of our big league club is I've been fortunate enough to be able to work with in some capacity.
And is that pretty much how it is in baseball? All these big names that we watch in the league championship series and all, that's how everybody does it. You come up through the system.
You come up through somebody's system, you know, and the job of the system is to prepare you not only to get there, but to be able to stay. And in our case, you know, to be able to get there and be able to perform at championship caliber level.
You had a lot of success out in Springfield. I don't know what I'm going to do with all my Springfield hats and polos and all that. Well, I have to go to the Memphis Redbirds store and see what all they got.
Yeah.
But what's your first order of business? You're replacing the... What has happened to the AAA manager of the Redbirds?
Ron Warner, we call him Pop.
Pop Warner.
Pop has taken a job as our infield coordinator, which means he'll go through our system and work with the infielders, and it allows him to expand his career. So the AAA job opened, and they were gracious enough to give me an opportunity to go into Memphis.
After being on a short list for a bench coach under Mike Matheny.
Yeah, that was a real flattering opportunity to know that you were considered for that opportunity moving forward in St. Louis. And, you know, like I say, very, very flattering to such a great organization.
And nice to be noticed and recognized.
Always nice to be thought of, absolutely. So, yeah. But I'm very excited about the opportunity in Memphis and go and continue to help
So the manager's left, but most everybody else is staying. All your other coaches?
Yeah, the same staff's involved. Brian Eversgerd, our pitching coach, who I had with me in Springfield in 2012, just a first-rate guy. And
you know a lot of these people anyway.
Yeah, it's a great staff, and I'm just going to try to plug in and keep things moving.
You had a lot of success out there. Won the pennant in 2012 with the Springfield team. But also, aside from all that, I've never been to Springfield, but you set all kind of attendance records out there. You had a lot more people attending these double A games than people attend triple A games and with other organizations. Just a town rallying around a team. I mean, they're turning out, you know, I mean, like 9,000 people that attend these games.
Yeah, no, it's Cardinal country. You know, we're 3 hours southwest of St. Louis and Springfield.
Okay. Yeah.
So it's a big, identify with the club. It's owned by the team. It's a beautiful stadium, Hammonds Field. Matt Gifford, the general manager there, does a tremendous job. They get in the community. And people do, to your point, they rally around the team. And, you know, we had a good club in 2012, and people identify with that, and they got excited about St. Louis has played well, which we typically do, but they started to see guys. It's the 10th year of the organization, so I think what took place is over a period of time, some of the players are coming through, started playing St. Louis. So people started to identify with the fact that, hey, this guy that I saw here a year, 2 years later, I'm seeing play in St. Louis. So that cycle started to take place. So now people are going to say, I want to make sure I see Carlos Martinez pitch, because I'm there's a good chance I'm going to see him in St. Louis.
So even more so now with the Redbirds in Memphis being AAA?
Yeah, it'll be interesting because we just bought the team in Memphis. Memphis has drawn well. They're redoing a lot of that stadium, making a lot of improvements this offseason, and really making an effort to continue to get in the community. It's very
And it holds more people,
and
bigger
stadium. It is a little bit bigger stadium, so I would expect there to be a real push to continue to create interest there.
You know, we're out of time, but before we go completely, I want to ask you, just for a lot of folks out there listening, we had an opportunity this year, or last year, we had two teams here in the county that both made a state championship. It was Weddington and Piedmont. Mm-hmm. Both of them won last year, and then this year we had another one won in Piedmont go, and they won. So for baseball is big in Union County, especially Piedmont and Weddington. They have a lot of really good players. Any advice from the coaching side of you for these young guys, these high school players, or what to do and how to proceed forward?
Well, Shane, you're right. It's always been a really good area. Monroe baseball has been really good. I played back when Jeff McNeely was coming through, and Andy Tomerlin played against those guys in the Legion ball. But the best advice I can give is to just enjoy the game. Appreciate the game, enjoy the time that you have in the game, and then beyond that, if you have any, just try to understand what kind of player you are. You know, once you understand what kind of player you are, you can work and maximize and work towards your skill sets. And
so, in other words, figure out what you're good at.
Figure out what you're good at. Be able to repeat it. And the guys that can repeat what they do consistently can play higher.
And one other thing, the Charlotte Knights, what are they? Are they a double A or triple A?
They're a triple A club with the White Sox organization.
Okay. And then you don't play them.
Obviously. I wish we did. I wish we were in that league. We're in the Pacific Coast League. So Memphis is the most eastern team in the league.
Oh,
and we
go
out and play, you know, again, Pacific Coast. We play in Fresno, Tacoma. And it'd be nice to be able to come and be in the International League and get to Charlotte and be.
Other people say, "Oh my God, you've been all over the country. Tell me what it's like." Yeah, you've seen hotels all over the country. It's not exactly
hotels, ballparks, and late night drive-throughs.
Like, yeah, I've been in 44 states, but all I've seen is the McDonald's and the motel. It's not.
That's right.
And Mike, I do want to ask you before we go. This week, a trio of dominant pitchers: Randy Johnson, Pedro Martinez, John Smoltz, and 3,000-hit second baseman Craig. Biggio is the first four-man Hall of Fame class in 60 years, and what well-deserved players.
Sure.
What about these guys, and what's great for these guys, a lot of them, that was the steroids era,
right,
for them to make it through. What about some of these other people that have that asterisk in our minds, so to speak? Do you ever see them getting into the Hall?
I think it's going to be difficult. I can see it as you know, time always heals wounds, so to speak. And then you've got the Veterans Committee with the Hall of Fame that and I don't know the parameters of when guys are eligible for that. I know they have a window of 10 years they can go into.
And
the,
some of them are getting close to that.
They're
end,
getting
yeah.
close. I don't see it. A lot of those guys, you know, they're it's going up or down a tick, but it's not close enough to the 75% that's going to allow them to get in. So I don't see that happening. Mm-hmm. But I could see 20 years from now that Veterans Committee and Tom Eroden saying, and a stance potentially softening for some guys.
If you come off that list because of 10 years, can you get back on it, or is that it?
I don't believe you can get back on it to the writers.
Oh.
But I do think you graduate into that committee of, like Ron Santo didn't go through that period with the writers, but then got to the Veterans Committee where players that are in the Hall of Fame, and I'm not sure the component of it, so I don't want to speak, I can't speak too credibly to it, like, but in broad strokes, you know, former members or members of the Hall of Fame have an ability to put people in the hall that once they get to a certain point. And I think that could happen with a few of the guys.
Well, you mentioned time heals all wounds. So can be said for Pete Rose.
We'll see. Yeah. I mean,
is he saying all the right stuff?
I think he's saying and doing all the right things.
He just did the wrong things for so many years.
He did. And it was just part of the, I mean, it was a clear violation of the Hall of Fame's credentials of being able to be entered. And until they change that, he just, it's not going to happen for him, which, you know, you can get into whether the Hall of Fame is about morality or baseball or play. And, but I do appreciate the Hall of Fame appreciates and respects the integrity of the game and the character of the person as well.
Mm-hmm. Thank Mike, you, we really appreciate you coming down and chatting with us, and we'll continue to follow the Cardinals. We were out there last January for a convention, and although there's no baseball being played, I mean, even though they got a football team and got a pretty good hockey team out there, it is all Cardinal logo jackets, hats. It was just all Cardinals.
It's a CRN, a special place, and we're biased. I'm biased, obviously, but best fans in baseball.
And I was out there the day that Stan Musial died. And
that's right.
Well, we said, well, let's walk over to the stadium. Hundreds of people standing out in the cold. At the statue, and I mean, crying, just openly crying. It was amazing.
Yeah, it's a real fabric, and the team takes it serious too. We're part of the community, and the community's part of us. And
that's great.
And it's a really special place.
Thank you, Mike.
We appreciate
Thanks,
it.
Thanks, Shane. Mm-hmm.